In April 2008, the South Florida Water Management District was featured in the Miami Herald, highlighting efforts to improve the water quality in the greater Everglades watershed. Over the last few decades, water quality improvement has become a critical priority as a result of the 1988 lawsuit filed by the federal government against the state of Florida. The lawsuit alleged violations of the Federal Clean Water Act that allowed high levels of total phosphorus to pollute the Everglades. The lawsuit was settled in 1991, and a consent decree was issued by the federal court that mandated constructed wetlands, establishment of a total phosphorus water quality standard, and agricultural best management practices. As a result, efforts to reduce phosphorus and other nutrients that pollute waterways have become a keystone restoration goal, and the South Florida Water Management District has expended almost $3 billion in a remarkable effort to reduce phosphorus. Today, the vital question is, how can we restore the flow of enough clean, fresh water through the Everglades and down to Florida Bay? Known as stormwater treatment areas, STAs are constructed wetlands, the largest in the world, designed to remove phosphorus from the water as it flows south through the Everglades and into Florida Bay. Excess phosphorus in the Everglades comes from the Everglades Agricultural Area, called EAA for short, and surrounding basins and urban areas. Excess phosphorus results in an overgrowth of cattail, a native species that outcompete native plants like sawgrass under high phosphorus conditions. STAs harness the ability of wetland plant roots to remove dissolved phosphorus from the water as a needed nutrient for their growth, and to filter particles suspended in the water that contain phosphorus. Over the course of this video, we will explore the history, function, challenges, operation, and benefits of this natural water cleaning system, and discuss the vital ways it fits into the larger picture of the Everglades' need for clean, fresh water. Beginning in the early 1900s and expanded in the 1950s as part of the Central and Southern Florida Flood Control Project, extensive dredging led to a massive rerouting of water, changing South Florida's water flow. Prior to alteration of the landscape by people, water moved south, from the upper chain of lakes, down the Kissimmee River, through Lake Okeechobee, and into the Everglades in a broad expanse of slow-moving water described by Marjorie Stoneman Douglas as the River of Grass. However, a desire to provide flood control and water supply to a rapidly increasing population led to the construction of canals, levees, water control structures, and pumps that now divert Lake Okeechobee water to the east and west coast estuaries. The channelization of the Everglades watershed has created two major problems. First, it drastically reduced the amount of water flowing through the Everglades to Florida Bay. Secondly, it increased agricultural and urban development, both of which introduced high levels of phosphorus into the greater Everglades. Historically, the Everglades ecosystem was adapted to ultra-low levels of total phosphorus, at or below 10 parts per billion. Plants and animals adapted to these low levels of phosphorus, and even very small increases from human activities can cause undesirable changes in the Everglades. Today, stormwater runoff carries nutrients off the landscape from agricultural and urban settings, often leading in the past to phosphorus levels reaching well over 200 parts per billion. In response to the federal lawsuit settlement and consent decree, the Florida government passed the Everglades Forever Act in 1994 to enact and fund the requirements of the consent decree. One component of this bill required the construction of stormwater treatment areas, known as STAs, as part of the Everglades Construction Project, a collaboration between the South Florida Water Management District and the Army Corps of Engineers. STAs are constructed wetlands that use the green technology of plants and algae to filter and store excess nutrients, like phosphorus from stormwater, before it reaches the greater Everglades. Beginning in the mid-90s, 23,000 hectares south of Lake Okeechobee have been transformed into five STAs, many of these located on former agricultural land in the Everglades agricultural area. These STAs capture and filter water that is discharged from the EAA and the surrounding basins before it is released into the Everglades. STA 1 West, located northwest of the Arthur R. Marshall Loxahatchee National Wildlife Refuge, is 4,500 hectares in size. It was completed in 1995 and expanded in 2018. Another expansion to STA 1 West is expected to be completed by the end of 2022. STA 5-6, located southwest of Lake Okeechobee, is 5,800 hectares in size and was completed in 1998 and expanded in 2012. This STA treats water discharged from the C-139 basin. STA 2, located southeast of Lake Okeechobee, is 6,300 hectares in size. It was completed in 2000 and expanded in 2012. STA 3-4, located just north of Water Conservation Area 3A, was completed in 2004 and is 6,600 hectares in size. And STA 1 East, completed in 2005, is 2,000 hectares in size. As water enters an STA, it moves through a series of treatment cells, following a route known as a flowway. Each cell is distinguished by particular wetland plants and/or algae that thrive under the water quality and quantity conditions that prevail in that cell. The first cells in the flowway typically are dominated by emergent aquatic vegetation, which include plants like cattails, bulrush, and spikerush that thrive on high concentrations of phosphorus. Farther along the flowway, there is a mix of emergent and submerged aquatic vegetation. Submerged aquatic vegetation consists of plants like southern naiad and algae. As these wetland plants progress through their life cycle and die, some of the phosphorus contained in the partially decomposed plants becomes permanently stored in the wetland peat soil. The operation and maintenance of the 24 pump stations, 350 water control structures, and over 600 miles of interior levees and canals are integral components of STAs, ensuring that they maintain proper water capacity and flow to optimize the reduction of phosphorus levels as the water moves through each cell. Each STA is unique, not only due to their size and the amount of water that they treat, but also because of their differences in soil type, previous land use, and vegetation cover. As a result, each STA requires tailored operations and maintenance that adjust for these specific conditions. STAs are living wetlands, and as such, they are affected by weather. Florida has distinct wet and dry seasons. From June to October, STAs receive about 66% of their annual rainfall and inflows, and that percentage can increase because of hurricanes and other tropical weather systems. Like any wetland ecosystem, water balance is critical. In the wet season, extended deep water conditions can stress vegetation and cause die-offs. But water is also needed during the dry season to maintain the STA vegetation. Drought conditions can decimate marsh vegetation and decrease phosphorus removal effectiveness. Therefore, drier periods have to be just as carefully monitored as wetter periods. If an STA cell dries up and then later inundated with water, it can cause phosphorus to be released from the soil instead of being stored in the soil. Maintaining proper water quality and quantity is a challenging balancing act, but South Florida Water Management District scientists and managers have become experts at the task. As a result, water depth is monitored closely using water stage recorders. Each cell is carefully monitored and maintained by scientists and technicians who collect real-time data sent to them remotely from the field. This data is then processed, vetted, and made available to the public through the South Florida Water Management District's environmental database called DB Hydro. The amount of water inflow to the STAs is dependent on the rainfall runoff patterns from the source basins. STAs in the Everglades agricultural area were designed to treat about 3/4 inches of runoff per day. For optimized health, the STA's target water depth is between 38 and 46 centimeters, or 15 to 18 inches. However, water levels can reach up to 4 feet deep. South Florida Water Management District Chief Engineer John Mitnick describes the importance of managing the water going into the STAs.
So what you see behind me here today is one of our stormwater treatment areas. A stormwater treatment area provides a vital water quality role in the overall functions of the flood control system. During dry times, water from Lake Okeechobee is moved south into stormwater treatment areas to maintain and ensure the survival of the vegetation within the stormwater treatment areas.
In addition to weather, STA function can also be impacted by plant overgrowth and invasive species. Therefore, proactive vegetation management, including the planting of native plant species and the use of herbicides to control invasives, is vital to an STA's success. During the wet season, STAs can often reach their maximum capacity to filter water, and water managers have to send that excess water in different routes, dumping some of the water to tide on the east and west coasts of Florida. We waste 1.7 billion gallons of water to tide on average each day. Flow equalization basins, known as FEBs, are reservoirs located upstream of some STAs that can hold peak stormwater flows, increasing the ability of water managers to provide the optimum flow quantities and flow timing to the STAs. Two FEBs have been in operation since 2015 and 2017. During that time, the need to send water from Lake Okeechobee to the STAs during the dry season has been greatly reduced. When all three of these FEBs are complete, they will store about 116,000 acre-feet of water. An additional effort that increases the effectiveness of STAs is the use of best management practices for agricultural areas. These BMPs help by removing nutrients at their source, ultimately preventing the amount of nutrients flowing into an STA. Typical best management practices include improved fertilizer application techniques, control of soil erosion, and improved water retention and management techniques. Over the last few decades, STAs have been a crucial component in reducing phosphorus levels in the water discharged to the greater Everglades. While the primary purpose of the STAs is to provide water quality improvement, they provide habitat for wildlife, and they provide the public with recreational opportunities such as birding, fishing, and hunting. The process of learning and continual improvement is an important aspect of the Everglades STAs, because this is the first time that these massive constructed wetlands have been implemented at such a large scale anywhere in the world. The goal of each STA is to decrease phosphorus levels so that water flowing south through the Everglades has levels at or below 10 parts per billion. As of 2019, STAs have treated more than 22 million acre-feet of water, storing about 2,800 metric tons of phosphorus. With the green technology of STAs, the potential exists for a healthy Everglades, with clean water throughout its vast expanses.